What is common in most movies these days is that they have no distinctive or unique devices in their movies. Take the generic blockbuster, for example, here, San Andreas, directed by Brad Peyton. There is nothing to distinguish itself from any other film, nothing to make you say, yes, I know for a fact that that is a Brad Peyton movie, judging by his unique style and colour, script and framing. This has been the case for years now, and unfortunately, it's making movies grow stale, not boring, but not new, unique. Only occasionally does a director come along to make a truly unique, different piece. The director of Hot Fuzz, here, Baby Driver, and Shaun of the Dead, Edgar Wright, is a prime example of this. There's quick, snappy cuts and exceptional visual comedy, as seen here. However, it's not just in one of his movies, it's in all of them. I believe what makes a film director so great is that they must have their own genre, their own unique style of directing. This is why my favourite director is the one and only Wes Anderson. I think there are four types of techniques which define Anderson's movies. So in this video I will go through them and show you how he is such a unique director. I think whenever Wes Anderson is brought up in a conversation, there is usually one thing brought up about his movies, which is, of course, the symmetry. Anderson's obsession with this is evident from the moment you begin to watch any of his films, especially his later ones. Nearly every frame is perfectly symmetrical, with his love and obsession for symmetry, making his movies so different and visually brilliant. Taking inspiration from directors such as Stanley Kubrick, Anderson's technique is composed as flat and symmetrical, making his films seem, in a way, like a child's storybook. With the flat symmetry of his shots injected with a purposefully chosen colour palette, it gives an atmosphere of whimsicality and quirkiness, which most directors and filmmakers find extremely hard to perform. By giving his movies a storybook feel, his characters feel a lot more drawn than captured, giving them a more personal, intimate connection with the audience. While most good directors chose to have dynamic, very deep shots, Anderson's are the opposite of this. This helps the audience understand much more clearly what is going on in the scene as well. His technical precision and symmetry are a signature part in why his movies are so engrossingly unique and why he is one of the most different directors working today. Just take a shot from, like, The Fantastic Mr. Fox. It's perfectly symmetrical and uniquely framed. No other director can pull it off like he can. So on the subject of his technical precision, let's move on to possibly his second most distinctive style, the intricately chosen colour palette. Layered onto these symmetrical shots, Anderson's colour palette is purposefully chosen to reflect the mood of the scene and to also reflect the setting where the scene takes place. Purposefully selected colour of clothes to match the mood, or the intricately designed furniture in the house to reflect the setting. All the colours chosen are there for a reason. To create a feeling of sadness or loss in his movies, Anderson mutes his usually vibrant palette to blues and greys, and also, what people don't realise, lessens the prominence of patterns on furniture or clothing. If the characters are experiencing happiness in the scene, usually the colour of the palette will be much brighter, and the opposite of sadness in the scene, patterns will have greater prominence on clothing and furniture. This is to, like we mentioned before, create a storybook feel. Children's books, when there is a mood swing, for example, loss, there is an obvious lack of vibrant colours. Wes Anderson uses this to create the storybook, and also to do something else, in which we shall mention later on. This is another technique which distinguishes itself from other directors. Some directors more experienced with conveying emotion what the characters are feeling to the surroundings. We'll sometimes do this more subtly. However, it is obvious with Anderson's movies that he does not. He completely transforms the colour palette to fit with his character's emotion, and goes above and beyond by even changing his character's surroundings, from the patterns on the wallpaper to the patterns of their clothes. An example of this could be shown here with the grey, flinty coastal backdrop of Moonrise Kingdom. Perhaps here with the vibrant yellow, red and orange Indian provinces of the Darjeeling Limited. Linking on how to the colour scheme creates the storybook aesthetic, let's look at it in a bit more detail, while also looking at how many of his main adult characters actually ties into this. Creating these perfectly symmetrical, vibrantly and specifically coloured and patterned shots, Anderson manages to produce a familiar feeling to the old children's storybooks associated with our childhood. In these shots, it presents the audience with an almost childlike, innocent view of the world around us and the mature themes given to the audience. This is entirely intentional by Anderson. Nearly all of his characters are incredibly immature and do sometimes act like children in reaction to the incredibly deep adult themes of his movies. All of these are recurring themes that contrast the aesthetic sphere they inhabit. This colourful aesthetic of the scenes reflect the childish actions we see by many of the characters. What is more interesting is that nearly all of the children in the films are incredibly sensible and mature for their age. We see this particularly in Moonrise Kingdom, where we are with children for most of the film. These kids are extremely grown up, fending for themselves in the wild woods of the New England island they inhabit. If you have seen Moonrise Kingdom, you will know that two of the children run away from the difficult homes to live in the woods and forests, camping and showing maturity in their actions. This is in stark contrast to the childlike reactions of the adults in the film, the act of hysteria and irresponsibility, which is again reflected by the storybook qualities shown in every frame. We discussed earlier on how the storybook feeling of the films also make the characters more drawn than captured by a camera. This in essence gives subconscious connection to the characters on screen. The audience feels that they now have a more personal, intimate connection. Something which a director strives to do throughout the films. This is again how Anderson is above and beyond most directors. He reflects the aesthetic of the scenes and atmosphere onto the story and character by using colour and storybook aesthetics to promote a feeling of immaturity and childlike irresponsibility among the adults, but also giving a feeling of connection to the characters. This is something an average director would never even attempt to do, let alone think about. Moving away from Anderson's unique technical precision, let's look towards his other frequently recurring features in this film, such as the main plots, his character types, etc. Firstly, we'll be beginning with the main plot of the story and what it revolves around, and how it makes him so different from other directors. In every single one of his movies, the main plot always seems to involve father-son relationships, to connect with their sons trying to connect with their fathers, boys in need of a father, fathers and sons trying to find each other, and a boy latching on to a father figure. Each one of these plots are in his movies. In some of his movies, it may not be so obvious, hidden within the story. However, if you look closer, you'll see it within them. If you have seen a Wes Anderson movie, try to remember the plot, and see if it revolves around a father-son relationship. Such as The Royal Tenenbaums, where a father tries to reconnect with his estranged family. Or the Grand Budapest Hotel, where a boy looks for a father figure in Monsieur Gustave, the hotel concierge. Or maybe the least obvious is in the Darjeeling Limited, where three brothers are going on a spiritual journey through India. Looking closely at the story, we see that the brothers are not just going on a passage through India, but also we see subtly how they grieve the loss of their father and how it has affected them in different ways. There are only three examples of how Anderson incorporates his father-son relationship into the stories, but they are all three sometimes deep in or in the main plot point. These are just a few reasons why Wes Anderson is one of the most unique directors working today, and why he is my favourite of all time.